गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम। यस मैम।
So, any doubts in yesterday's class? Any doubts in yesterday's class? First, what did we discuss in the last class? Can somebody brief down? What did we do in the last class? Sanjayan, can you summarize what we did in the last class?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. What did we discuss? I asked you to summarize, Sanjay. That's the reason you need to note it down when we are having a discussion in the class. Okay? So in the last class, I think we spoke about what is capacity. Capacity is the maximum output rate that can be obtained by a production or from a service facility, right? So capacity planning, we also is a process of establishing the output rate, right? So that is about the capacity planning. We saw how this capacity and its measures are related, right? So we saw its efficiency and utilization. We know the efficiency is actual output by efficiency capacity, and utilization is actual output by design capacity. Then we also saw the types of capacity. Can somebody tell what are the different types of capacity we had gone through yesterday? What are the types of capacity we had discussed?
Production capacity, design capacity, effective capacity, maximum
Maximum capacity. Maximum capacity is also called as your peak capacity. Okay. Then you also saw what are the determinants of effective capacity, like your product design, process design, the variations in the product, product quality, production scheduling, materials management, maintenance, right? So all these comes under the determinants of effective capacity. And we also saw the importance of capacity decisions. All these questions can come for, each can come for 10-10 marks. So you need to plan and prepare your answers according to it, right? So today we'll move down with three-step procedure for capacity planning decisions, right? So the capacity planning decisions, which is given as identifying capacity requirements, develop capacity alternatives, evaluate capacity alternatives. Now, like in any process, first of all, before starting, before you try to look into expanding your system or trying to know what is the actual process, you need to know what will be the requirements for the capacity, right? So you need to look into the each and nook and corner of the process and try to know what is the most need for the capacity enhancement. After you have identified the need for the capacity requirement, you have to have a certain prerequisite, or you should have studied the process that will give you the prerequisite that you're going to be planning for the capacity. Like if I take a bus company, right? If I take any BMTC bus, if you see during those festival days or during your Dasara time or Diwali time, the number of buses or trains will be increased in numbers, Have you observed that the number of trains from Bangalore to Mysore during Dasara, or number of buses that has to be increased during the period of Dasara from Bangalore to Mysore would have been increased in number? Why? Because there is a need for the demand, and they over the past data they would have observed the people were traveling by they were made by the bus might be overloaded, it might be people might be waiting for buses. To overcome that problem, what they would have done, they would have enhanced the number of buses during those peak time, right? When they feel that there is a demand for that, supply is more, then they would have enhanced the number of buses, and during the other time there would be a regular flow of the buses. Okay, so first we need to identify what is the need for enhancing your capacity, right? So after you have done, then you need to develop your capacity alternators. Like if I take an example of this bus company only, so what will be the alternatives that you need to develop? You need to look for if there are 8 people working through the normal shift, then you need to have more number of drivers and conductors rather than along with 8. You need to find out how many drivers are free, how many conductors are free. Then, based on the availability, how many buses can be accommodated, all these things you will make a plan, right? So after you have planned of all this, then you have to make sure that it balances, the number of buses balances with the number of drivers and conductors. After the effective alternative plan has been developed, then you will try to find out, you need to evaluate the process. How will you evaluate? You'll first find out, then you will try to communicate with the drivers and conductors. You'll try to find out how many buses are in working condition, whether they are having some other problem. All these conditions you will try to find out from that, and after trying to find out all these availabilities, you're going to make the effective plan by evaluating your capacity alternatives. Any doubts here? Was any doubts here? Is there any doubts here, boys? Am I clear? Adarsh?
Yes, ma'am.
Darshan, any doubts here? So there is no doubts here. So I can continue with the next slide. Is that clear? So now, with the same thing, I would like to give a one more example. When we are talking about the three-step procedure for making the capacity planning, so one more example is during the weekends and during the festival days or during the holidays, the parking facility that has to be organized in the malls. It can be any mall. You can take any example of any mall. So how they plan there will be always, if you have observed them, if you have visited the mall during the normal days and if you have visited the mall during the peak days, the arrangement that they have done during the peak days and the normal days, you can make a clear difference, saying that during the peak days, the number of the security guards would have been increased. The parking area, they would follow the correct exact principle. They want the car to be parked in the appropriate way, right? And the parking area also, the maximum utilization of the parking area will be followed, right? So these are some of the guidelines they use, the three-step procedure for planning the capacity decision, even in the malls. Like first, they need to identify the capacity requirement, that is their demand, then develop their capacity alternatives, that is try to find out all possible places where they can park, alternative security people, how they can enhance them into job, right? And what about incentives and what about wages? All those things they have to look into it. Then they need to evaluate their capacity alternatives. So this is also another example of how you can try to plan your capacity for the mall. There are plenty of examples which we can talk about the capacity planning decisions, right? So next step, steps of capacity planning. The steps of capacity planning is clearly given by, see, right from the measurements and metrology, you have been speaking about the steps of capacity planning. First, you need to estimate the future capacity requirements. So first, they you need to plan when you're trying to, when you're building any process, there is always a space, or there is should always a scope being provided to adapt to the future changes, future requirements. When you want to bring about any changes, whatever system you have developed, you have to always give provision for future capacity requirements. You should keep in mind that whatever the system requires an update, a provision must be provided for it, right? So next one will be, after you have given the provision, after you have developed a system by giving a provision for the future needs, then you will evaluate the existing capacity and facilities by to identify their gaps, right? So you will identify their gaps. What is the current situation? What will be the future situation? What are their gaps? By identifying how much gaps you can fill, all that you need to evaluate during this process. Then identifying, when you're trying to identify the gaps, right, there will be a plenty of alternatives. These alternatives can be obtained from the public, can be obtained from small group meeting, can be obtained by the different panel discussions, right? So all these alternatives will be developed. After these alternatives are developed, you will choose some of the alternatives which will be best for your system, right? So after you have analyzed and identified the best alternative that fits for your system, you will choose them, and then you will do a financial analysis. How effectively this one, how much money you need to invest for this process, how much the target, how much is going to take from the target line, how much from the investment money is going to flow into this analysis process. All these kind of financial analysis will be done here, right? Then out of all these analysis, you will choose the one which will take the least cost, right? So you're going to assess your key qualitative issues. From the beginning, I've been told we will go for any alternative which has the best project at the least cost, right? So we're going to choose even in your decision analysis, you've done problems based on that. You're going to choose the key qualitative issues which will give us the best value at the least cost. You're going to choose that. Then you also look for the long-term plan. You're not going to choose for whatever you choose should also configure towards your long-term plan, how effectively it will suit for your long-term, right? Then you're trying to implement this whatever alternative you have chosen in the process, and you're going to monitor the results. Right, if a monitor result must be done in the periodic steps, so that if there is any deviation, you can try and monitor and try to bring it in line control when the small deviations tend to happen. So you need to monitor your results right from the small step, right? So these will be the steps that we are discussing in the capacity planning, right? So next will be developing capacity alternatives, right? So developing capacity alternatives is when you're, I already said that there, when you're trying to design any system, there has to be a scope for future expansion, right? So when you're trying to have a future expansion, this brings about a kind of flexibility in the system, right? So flexibility usually will come in when you're talking about in the fixing of your equipment, or fixing about your layout, or fixing about your production planning or scheduling or inventory policies. So whatever it is, you need to bring about the flexibility in all these aspects so that the system, so that the operation of the flow of your process will be following a smooth line flow. There will be no bottlenecks, there will be no lags, there will be no lead times. So if the system flows smoothly, then you are focusing on moving towards a profit line, right? So this flexibility is very important in any system, so that it can suit for major applications and there will be no delay in the timeline or as well, right? So the next example is taking stage of life into account. Taking stage of life into account is basically you are always having a past data, and based on the past data, how you can accommodate, and you need to plan this process well in advance, right? So the life cycle always, see, if you take a year span from 2020, from Jan to December, if you take the lifespan, each month you're going to try to look back in the previous production cycle, that is from 2019 January to 2019 December, you're always taking the previous stage of life, previous stage of year as a reference for targeting for the next year, right? So you need to always have some past data for as your reference. Then you're going to take a big picture approach. Take a big picture approach to capacity changes means, basically, when you want to, big picture approach means when you want to expand something or when you want to try to bring about some kind of changes in the system, there has to be some kind of reference, right? So you can before you take a big leap into the process, you should be first of all justified with whatever changes that you bring into system is going to help you in making profit. All that has to be realized before you look into trying to bring about a changes in the system, right? The next one is prepare a deal to capacity chunks. Prepare a deal to capacity chunks means having different capacity solutions which are frequently discrete, right? So for example, if I take, if you produce 40 tens of units per hour, you need to, sometimes due to some lag, there can be a lag. So instead of producing 40 units, they can have 50 minutes, 55 units. So, or sometimes they can have 35 units. You need to always deal with different problems that you're going to face, right? So if you face, what you need to do, you need to attempt to smooth down your capacity requirements. Always, we cannot say during the production cycle all operations will go on smooth. There are periods, there are times where sometimes the equipment can have a problem with it, can sometimes the laborers can have a problem with it, sometimes the finishing might be a problem with it. So during these times, you need to have some kind of extra effort into it so that the small variations can be immediately corrected and you can attain your target level, right? So next one will be identifying the optimal operating level, right? So this is normally which is most requirement, which majority of the times are in production system will operate very normally, right? So it will be optimal, but during some stages there can be changes, but that is very minimal during any organization. So you need to look at working towards the optimal operating level, right? The last one is choose a strategy if expansion is involved. So before you choose a strategy, before you want to have your expansion, you should always think whether there is a demand, whether there will be a money flow if you do it, whether there is going to bring about profit, whether everybody is going to be benefited by this process. All these strategies must be well studied before you're trying to bring about some kind of expansions, or if you're trying to bring about some kind of flexibility into the system, or some kind of addition to the system, right? So this is the developing capacity alternatives. Any doubts here, boys? Are you following what I'm trying to tell?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Only Kartik Avasthi is following. Everybody is following.
The first point is about the remaining.
Fourth point. You're talking about fourth point.
Okay.
Prepare to deal with capacity chunks. Capacity chunks is like, we cannot say always there will be, the production line will flow very smoothly, right? At some time, the equipment can have a mishandling problem. Sometimes the labor can delay the process, right? You might have failed to switch on the system or something like that, right? So you have to always be, when there is any disturbance in the system, right? So you need, you know that in our production system, every time that the production counts, if you're at the end of the month, you need to, if you're producing 30 products per 30 products by the end of the month, you need to produce 30 products per month, right? But when you come across some problems like these capacity chunks, then you need to find an alternative and make sure that by the end of the month, you have 30 products. So what will be the alternative? By taking up OT or by bringing up a new extra machine or trying to outsource your small amount of work. So whatever is it, in or gradually, in place of producing 10 products per day, you tightly increase every day by 11 or 12, slowly 2 hours increase in the capacity. All that you can have in your alternatives of trying to meet up this capacity chunks. Am I clear, Tarun?
So it doesn't deal with like if we have extra raw materials and all, so that's not the part of the fourth point. No,
extra raw material will be there in the inventory, but we have, for example, if I take your class only, we have almost from 8:30 to 4:30. There are some of the days where you don't have lab in the afternoon. So during that time, if I say that, okay, students, you're all free in the afternoon, shall I take a class? Means, will you come up for the class? You usually show endurance, right? Even the same thing, even the employees of an organization, when they're asked to work a 8-hour shift, when they're asked to produce 10 products per day, they will focus themselves to produce only 10 products per day, right? Until unless the worst situation happens, right? So based on the target line only, they will work. They won't compromise on their tea break. They won't compromise on their lunch break. They won't compromise on their thing. It's the kind of scenario that that has been followed in the organization.
Yes, got it.
Got it? So if you're clear with this, I can move on with the next slide. Everybody? So next will be the capacity facility layout. Boys, November 5th will be your test. So I think I'm having this week and the next week. November 5th is on which day? Can anybody tell me? Which day is November 5th?
Thursday.
So hardly I will get Thursday. So today's class and tomorrow's class. Tomorrow I'm planning to solve some of the problems in capacity planning. So this theory part, whatever I'm discussing in today's class today, by the end of the day, I think I'll share this PPT in your Google Classroom. You can go through this. So whatever is done, the theory part, and tomorrow's class, the problems, the basic problems, like I plan to give only problems on capacity planning. Like you can expect those problems for your test. Is it clear? I'm repeating your portions for the test. You will have the complete forecasting module. That is module 2 completely you will have, including theory and problems. And in the module 3, the theory part will completely be there, but problems on capacity will also be included. Facility planning problems will be excluded. Am I clear, boys? Portions for the test?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we'll move down to what is a facility layout. So what is a layout? I think every time you vote, you write your lab records, we ask you to write the layout. So what do you understand from the layout? It's basically, the definition is given here only, the layout facility is the physical location of various departments or units of the facility within the premises of the facility. In the lab also, if you look at it, for each equipment, if you take your machine shop, you know how, where the lathes are, you know where is your grinding, you know where is your drilling machine, you know where is your milling machine, right? So each space has been allocated at their appropriate position where they have been, where they are fixed to be placed, right? So a layout will compromise of all these machines, and each one has its own positions which has been located in, right? So this is the concept of facility layout. Next one will be the departments may be located. What are the considerations we need to follow when we are doing the facility layout? Is it should have less walking distance, logical sequence. The processing of their equipment should be followed, and we must always have a medical kit in any lab. We also have in the labs also We have the medical kit. If you look at your production shop floor, everyone will have a medical kit, immediate first aid box they will have, right? And if you see in any assembly line, the logical sequence of processing, your assembly line will be planned according to the logical steps or sequence of processing. Okay, so these are the basic considerations that we have to keep in our mind when we are planning our layout, right? So what are the factors affecting the layout? So definitely the most important factors that we are affecting our layout will be the material. So when we are trying to plan your layout, you must keep your mind how material, the lines, the floor lines, how the for the movement of the material, how is it being planned, so that easy the handling of the material should be very should be equipped enough, right? So should be neatly handled without having any damage of the material. So while planning the layout, material plays a most important role. Then the product, the finished product after you have done shipping, it should be the product after it has been done for shipping, for transporting, for all those facilities also a option should be given. An exit door must be there so that when the product is being done, while if you're bringing back into the layout, it should not disturb the other facilities that are placed in the layout, or it should not damage the other facilities in the layout. So therefore there has to be a exit door, especially in a mechanical industries when you have casting process or when you have your big forging equipments. These will be after the assembly process, these will be very huge enough. So if they are brought back into the same production line, there are chances that they can damage the machine. So there should always be a provision for the exit door so that they will be removed without having any damages. Is it clear? The next point is your machinery. So when you're planning your layout, you have to always give appropriate spaces, clearance spaces, handling spaces. All spaces must be kept in mind when you're trying to fix your machinery, right? The machinery should also be firmly fixed in position so that the vibrations will not affect the process of machining, right? The next point will be the labor. So definitely any labor or any employee who's working in the job floor must be made sure that he's taking all safety measurements, right? And whichever environment is making, he should make sure that whatever gases or whatever should not affect him, right? So all these precautions must be taken with respect to the labor conditions. Then the location. You should always have your the layout should be always placed in a location where it can be easily, there should not be any time waste when you're moving from one plant to the other plant, right? So location must be interfixed and it should be in a logical sequence, it should have been planned. Then these policies also play a major role, the insurance, right? The raw material, safety guards, the damage facilities or damage policies for the raw materials, all should be well thought before you're planning your layout, right? Sometimes if the materials or if the machines have been damaged, then the policy should be that the company should give us some kind of marginal benefit in repairing or repairing these kind of equipments, right? Then definitely when you're planning your layout, the industry matters a lot, what type of industry we are having. So based on that only, the layout has to be planned. So industry play a major role in deciding our layout. Now, next, scope of facility layout, right? So why do we need? So it will be basically to have material handling and minimum transportation, and we need not have a long waiting time, right? We should have less waiting time for in-process inventory. This will be related to the material, related to workplace, safe working conditions, minimum movement of workers, least chance of accidents and fireworks, and proper space for machines, workers, and tools. It is self-explanatory here. Any doubts here? Can I move on?
No doubts.
These are the factors affecting. So I think factors affecting the layout and factors affecting our work closely. So availability of the raw materials, proximity of markets, transport facilities, availability. This can come for 1 6-mark question. Explain the factors affecting the location decision. So you're going to explain these six of them. minimum six of them, or if you can, if they have asked to list, you need to highlight all of these, right? So availability of the raw material, proximity of markets, transport facilities, availability of efficient and cheap labor, right? Availability of power and fuel, climatic and atmospheric conditions, availability of what? Availability of capital, social and recreational facilities, business and commercial facilities, existence of existence of related industries. All these factors must be considered while we are trying to plan our location decisions. Is it clear? Now, next we'll move on to types of layout. So in types of layout, the two types of layout which we always look at it or which we always keep off talking, it will be the process layout, and the next one will be the and product layout, right? So there are fixed layout and all that, all those we'll see one by then. So first one will be your process layout. So what is process layout? Suitable, it is suitable when the product having standard features is to be produced in large volumes, right? So specialized machines and equipments are arranged one after another in order of the sequence required in the production process, right? So this kind of layout, are you understanding what is process layout? It is the process layout. The layout will be arranged based on the process in which the raw material will be processed. The layout will be arranged in the order of which the raw material will be processed will be called as your process layout. The best example of your process layout will be any packing industries, food industries, especially. I'll come back to this example later, but if you have to understand the process layout, suppose if you're making biscuits, right? So what will be the order? First you need to, and the layout will be arranged in the order of, first you'll have a station where you need to bring all the raw materials, you need to blend all of them, right? After that, you will have the next procedure for mixing all of them, right? So next will be pouring them into the trays. After that, next station will be trying to pour them into the molds and keeping them in the oven. After it has been baked, then you're going to remove the biscuits from the tray. Then after that, 10 biscuits per pack, it has to be packed, and after that it has to be arranged so that it will not get damaged, right? So this sequence of order that we are arranging, right? So those things comes under the process layout. Any doubts in process layout? Suppose if you take your, if next example will be if you're taking your car for service, right? So the car for service will be arranged in the order of who is being delivered first, right? So if the first car will be, if the car that has come, car three has come first means, so it will be first brought here, it will be cleaned, it will be oiled, it will be greased, it will be cleaned, it will be washed, then it will go for outreach. Second car, it will also follow the same process line, then it will be delivered to the customer, then car one. So depending upon the order which the cars are flowing in, based on that the car will be serviced and will be delivered to the customer, right? So sometimes in most of the conveyor belt can be used, or normal flow line can be used. So any process in which the car will come, get serviced and leave the system, right? So based on that, the cars will be, based on the flow of the operations, the cars have been kept, right? So this was, you know, this is the condition which comes under the process layout, right? So we'll see next, we'll see the advantages. Greater flexibility, better and more efficient supervision is possible, right? Then capacity of different product line can be expanded easily, right? better utilization of men and machine. Nobody is idle. Everybody is, since it's a continuous process, everybody will be involved in one or the other work, right? So disadvantages will be, since it's a process layout, more floor space will be required because you need to arrange in the same order it is going to work, right? More work will be in progress. Sometimes by the end, if you're having 1 month schedule, sometimes by 28th only your production will be done. So those 2 days there might be idle time can be seen. So there may be more work in progress. So people are, since the job is done, so more work can come into the flow line, right? More distance traveled by the product, since it has to flow according to the work line. So definitely the raw material has to travel more distance by the product, right? So these are the advantages and disadvantages of a process layout. Next will be your product layout. And the product layout is basically for producing one standardized product, usually in a large volume. Right, it is just an example of your flow shop layout or straight line layout. Okay, the machines are arranged according to the progressive steps by which it is made, right? Like the chemical, paper, rubber refineries and cement industries, right? So yeah, can you see this raw material is being flowing, right? And then it is coming here, it is being refined, and then it is clean and it is going, right? So this raw material has to go to its own job station and get the job done. The better example will be like in your machine shop, all the lathe machines will be arranged in one place, all the milling machines will be arranged in one place, all the drilling machines will be arranged in one place. Now, a product which is coming, it has to get drilled, means it will go to the drilling station, get the job done, and then go to the milling machine. If it has to get the milling job done, then it will go to the, it is all based on the product. Okay, so what kind of operations has to be done? It will be defined according to the product, right? So the product, if it has to go through different series of operations, then it will go to the series of operations. Next, in the maybe in the next class, I'll show you a video on the arrangement of the different types of layout. Maybe that will give you a clear picture. When you see an example of the operations in the product and process layout, you will understand the process much better. Okay, so next will be the advantages. Mechanization of materials is possible, and material cost can be reduced because everything is done. When you have several raw materials, it has to go through a drilling means. All can be collected at a stretch and gone to the drilling machine. The drilling job will be done. So definitely material handling cost will be reduced, right? So it requires less floor area because all the machines are arranged in the group. So floor area will be reduced, facilitates better production control, production bottlenecks can be avoided because if because of one product, there is no stoppage of the entire process. So the production flow between for the other products will flow on. If one machine is spoiled also, the other flow will continue, right? So disadvantages is expansion of product line is difficult. There is a difficulty in supervising, breakdown of equipments disrupt the production. These will be, if one equipment is disturbed, the entire production can slow down the process. So this will be the disadvantages of your product layout. Then this is group technology. Group technology is similar to the working of your product layout. You can see all the drilling machine, the office, the work cell, the tool room, everything is arranged in. It is being grouped, right? So you have the working operations have been grouped and the operation will be done according to that, right? So group technology layout is a cellular manufacturing layout. It is made for single family part. Parts with common characteristics. In this layout, dissimilar machines are grouped into cells. Each cell functions like product layout. It also functions like product layout. Especially if I take a car company, if I take one Hyundai car company, right? But in the Hyundai car company, there are different variants. They can be different variants. It can have i10, it can have i20, it can have Accent. It can have different variants, but some of the majority of the components may be the same thing, but some variations among these components will be there. So it will be grouped according to their operation. So if you want your tires, it will go here. If you want your axle blades, it will go here. If you want IC engines fixing, it will go here. So based on their grouping of functions, it will be done. So that's the concept of grouping technology layout, right? So advantages is definitely reduces the material cost, reduces work and process inventory, automate the production, but flexibility will be greatly reduced. Is it clear? So next will be the fixed position layout. Fixed position layout is something you have this, all the tools, all the labors are brought close to this machine and they will work upon this machine or will work upon the specimen, right? So in such kind of layout we call as a fixed position layout, where the just a second, boys. So we were talking about the fixed position layout. In the fixed position layout, the raw material or the workforce or the job that has to be done, to this job, all the labors, all the tools will be carried to this place and the job will be done, right? Because of this big in size, so when due to the size, shape and other characteristics constraint, the products cannot be moved, therefore the machine and operations move around the product, right? So this is about the fixed position layout, right? Especially construction of air buildings, construction of a building, assembly of an aircraft, ship, all these things will be under the case of fixed position layout. The advantages will be less investment is required in this kind of layout, because as a system we need not have anything, everything will be space requirement will be very less for this, and less transport costs as bulky machines are not to be moved, right? So this we talk about your facility layout. In the facility layout we also should know what are the factors affecting a layout. Same thing we have seen. So factors affecting a layout we have seen, right? So then the other important question for us for when we are discussing about the facility layout will be factors influencing the layout. It will be the factory building, nature of product, production process, type of machinery, repairs and maintenance, human needs and plant requirement. So these will be the factors influencing the layout, right? So next one, principle of a good plant layout. What are the principles of a good plant layout? Means maximum flexibility it should have, right? Then it should have the coordination must be provided to the maximum extent, right? Then maximum visibility should be there, right? And minimum movement of materials, machine, men, all such movement should be minimized, right? So minimum discomfort should be there. So when employees are working or when workers are working, uncomfortable should not be provided. They must be the layout should be developed in such that the workers can work on their on the machines with ease, right? It should have minimum handling, right? So handling of material should be to the minimum, right? Then safety aspects, definitely when we are working in a layout, the safety must be one of the key target for us, whether all safety precautions, if they're working with any plant should be provided with fire extinguishers, right? And safety kit should be provided, right? You need to have a doctor to the nearest, right? All these are very important safety aspects. Next will be the efficient process flow. A good layout is one that makes the material to move in forward direction towards the completion stage. The next one will be identification. Every plant layout should be identification. Each one should have a board. If there a board should be placed, walking lane should be the board for a walking place should be provided. So a plant layout must have identification to identify each target of aspect is very important when you're planning a good plant layout. I'm repeating the principles of a good plant layout should be good plant layout should be maximum flexibility, maximum coordination, maximum visibility, minimum movement, minimum discomfort, minimum handling, safety aspects, and efficient process flow. And the last one, the identification process should be easy. Is it clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So,
yes, ma'am.
From maybe in tomorrow's class, I'll start solving problems. If you all have no doubts, any doubts? So, what are the important theory questions? Can you quickly take down the important theory questions in the facility planning and capacity? Are you taking down those?
Yes, sir.
First question.
Ma'am, this is for capacity planning only.
Capacity and facility plan.
One more. 1 minute, ma'am.
Okay. Boys, for this complete capacity and location planning or the facility planning, for this I've completely referred Srinivas Reddy and Mukundaya. The David Trompton book has more, I mean, you can, the content is very minimum there. And if you look at your syllabus and if you look at this book, the content has been planned according to your syllabus. So you can refer Srinivas Reddy and Mukundaya Ravi Kumar for this unit. Okay. The college is open, the libraries are open. You can come and take your books and go, or you can take a Xerox copies of these textbooks and go. So maybe for capacity and facility planning, I want you to refer Srinivas Reddy and Mukundaya Ravi Kumar. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So first question, list and explain the factors affecting the capacity.
Ma'am, can you repeat?
List and explain. List and explain the factors affecting capacity. Explain the types of capacity. Next question. Explain types of capacity. Next question. Explain the determinants of effective capacity. Next question. Explain the steps for capacity planning. Done?
Yes, done.
Next question. Elaborate on elaborate on developing capacity alternatives and evaluating developing and evaluating alternatives. Elaborate on developing and evaluating capacity alternatives. With a neat sketch, explain process and product layout, stating its advantages and disadvantages. Process and product layout. With a neat sketch, stating its advantages and limitations. See, since all questions is 10 marks, you need to write down all the points. Like last time, since it is only 6 marks, all that I don't want. Each question is, you need to answer for 10 mark question itself. Okay? Then factors, explain the factors. Factors influencing a layout, factors affecting a location decision. List the factors affecting a layout. Last question, explain the plan layout. Principles of a good plant layout. What are they? Maximum flexibility, then maximum coordination, visibility. One moment. Discomfort. Okay, then with this I'll stop. Abhishek GL, Sai Sumant. साई सुमंत, अभिषेक जीएल, अभिषेक नारायणा, अजय सुनील.
यस मैम.
मैम आदर्श देसाई प्रेजेंट.
ओके अजय सुनील. अक्रम अनवर
प्रेजेंट मैम.
मैम फोर प्रेजेंट.
ओके मैम फोर प्रेजेंट गिवन. अक्षय जी प्रेजेंट. ओके अलक
प्रेजेंट मैम.
अंकित, आशुतोष
प्रेजेंट मैम.
विधान, चिन्मय
प्रेजेंट मैम.
चंदन स्वरूप, करिश्मा
प्रेजेंट मैम.
दर्शन
प्रेजेंट मैम.
इबाद
प्रेजेंट मैम.
गोविंदराज, गुड्डा जयंत रेड्डी
प्रेजेंट मैम.
पुरुषोत्तम
प्रेजेंट मैम.
ऋतिक शाह
यस मैम.
जयंत पंचाली
प्रेजेंट मैम.
जितिन
यस मैम.
चैतन्य
प्रेजेंट मैम.
करमजीत सिंह, कार्तिक अवस्थी
प्रेजेंट मैम.
किरण किरण, मोहम्मद मस्तानुल्ला, माजिन, शरण, नरेंद्र सदानंद
प्रेजेंट मैम.
निहाल युशेट्टी
यस मैम.
निखिल, निमला वाग्मेश
यस मैम.
नितिन नितिन प्रज्वल
यस मैम.
प्रयाग
यस मैम.
प्रिंस प्रभाकर प्रिंसन
यस मैम.
रक्षित
मैम.
ऋषि
प्रेजेंट मैम.
संदीप पी, संजय गौड़ा
यस मैम.
संजय एन
यस मैम.
सतीश शंकर
यस मैम.
सौरभ
यस मैम.
शिवम
यस मैम.
शिवम सुंदरिया
यस मैम.
श्रवण सलूजा
यस मैम प्रेजेंट.
श्रीनिधि, सिद्धार्थ ए, सिद्धार्थ आर सोनू, सुदीप के एस, सुदीप के एस, सुनील कुमार जी, तरुण, विनय जे, विपिन सिंह
यस मैम.
विवेक एस
प्रेजेंट मैम.
मिलन देन प्रणया लाल मुलपट्टी
प्रेजेंट मैम.
सक्षम सिंह, सक्षम सिंह, अक्षत बी एस
प्रेजेंट मैम.
चैतन्य
यस मैम.
महेश, निशांत, रमेश, शशांक एस
यस मैम.
स्मरण, सौतिक रॉय, जाहिर हुसैन. ओके देन थैंक यू. मीट इन टुमारोज क्लास. ओके आई विल शेयर योर पीपीटी. सो आई एम नॉट गिविंग एनी क्विज. सो आई एम शेयरिंग योर पीपीटी. यू कैन गो थ्रू द पीपीटी. इफ यू हैव एनी डाउट्स वी कैन हैव अ डिस्कशन बिफोर आई स्टार्ट अवे विद द प्रॉब्लम्स. ओके सो दैट विल बी द एक्टिविटी विच आई एम गिविंग यू टुडे. So today you can go through the complete set of PPTs. If you have any doubts, any discussions, that we can start with the discussion in tomorrow's class and then start for solving the problems for tomorrow's class. Is it clear?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Okay then, thank you.
हेलो हेलो तरुण Yeah. Should we start now?
Only 6 minutes.
Okay, we'll start the class now. Okay.
Yes, sir.